morning and welcome to our worship this morning. It's lovely to see you. We've had three now carol services, and it was a real treat yesterday afternoon here and yesterday evening, and also we've had a carol service this morning at St. Luke's, and of course there is just the one other opportunity to join together, and I think there's some spaces this evening at 6 o'clock here. Please do come along if you haven't been to the carol service, or maybe I should call it more of a carol concert. Then please just let Vicky know that you're coming. It's helpful, obviously, just to keep an eye on numbers in these days, as it were. So, gosh. Another change to what's happening, isn't it? And I know there's lots of people thinking, oh my goodness, what are we going to do for Christmas? Well, can I give you a clue? The best thing you can do for Christmas is to worship Jesus, the reason behind the season. So I feel in a way, and we've talked a bit about at St. Luke's this morning, that actually all of these things, they could bring us down, they could make us very upset, but actually, in a way, it's trying to focus us on what the season is really about. And so let's just give thanks in a way to God for this opportunity to really focus on the reason behind the season. And of course we have some other services coming up next week. Please do have a look on your notices, because actually where they're held and when, you will need to just take extra special note for. I'm looking over Matthew in the corner there. Hello Matthew. Do you want to say something about the Nativity? That would be really helpful. I should give you a microphone. Hold on.
Yes, so our Nativity service will be happening at 4 o'clock here, and it's going to be fun. It's going to be new. It's going to be different and COVID safe. So the way it will roughly work is we're going to have people, invite people to come in their costumes, and we're also going to provide a few costumes as well for those who you might not have. And we're just going to put words up on a screen and get people to shout out as we go along, but also not shout too loud because of COVID. So it's all going to be fun and experimental and different. And it's all also going to feature a certain guest star, specifically a particular donkey of my acquaintance. It's going to appear in a certain starring role, maybe even multiple starring roles. We'll have to wait and see how that might go. But it's going to be a brilliant time. It's going to be a lot of fun. Any family or friends who maybe don't usually come along to church but might be excited to come for this particular service, please do invite them along. Brilliant to have a packed out church full of people enjoying the great Nativity story. So, yeah, looking forward to that.
Thank you, Matthew. And just to say that if you think about the sort of words that are going to be on the screen, then that might be a clue as to the character that you can come dressed up as. Think of Nativity. Think of shepherds. Think of angels. Think of whatever things that you want to come dressed as, because then you're going to be able to join in with what is happening at 4 o'clock on Christmas Eve. And then another change to our normal schedule is that at 11:15 in the evening we will be starting our midnight communion, and that's important because it's going to be, I'm saying it because it's going to be here this year, obviously for space. If you want to take your Christmas Day communion, that's your first opportunity here. And because you've got nothing else to do but to come and worship Jesus on his birthday, then of course there is two opportunities on Christmas Day in the morning, 9:30 9:30 at St. Luke's, and there is 11 o'clock here. What better way to celebrate Christmas this year than with your Christian family? So please do just make a note and come along for that. I'm going to ask, is there anything I've forgotten? One other thing, the identity course. Are the leaflets out for the service? Are there leaflets on the side? Yes, so there are some little leaflets. They are for a course in the new year, and they're an opportunity to go deeper into our Christian faith and understanding. It's based on John's Gospel. I'm quite excited about it because I've looked at it, and I think it's really a really great way of learning about the Christian faith and going deeper. And so please pick up one of those. It's going to be online, and Matthew is putting that together for the new year, and it'll start on a Thursday evening from the 14th of January. So please do pick up one of those leaflets as you go out if you haven't seen about that, but it is detailed also in here. Simon. The flower rota. Yes, so thanks for the reminder. If you like decorating, if you like flower arranging, and if you're anything like my flower arranging, don't get too involved in this, but if you like to do that, there is a rota for the flowers. Please do put your name on that. Where is this rota? So it needs to come onto this table for when people leave. So because people won't be going that way, of course, as always, we go out through the bell tower doors as soon as we finish our worship. I think it just leaves me to invite Greg now to light the fourth Advent candle and to drink.
Just before I do that, I just want to, obviously last week I asked, mentioned that a lady who contacted us for help. Can't thank you enough for the response. In the conversation, Roy said he would speak to the Rotary Club that he belongs to, and they contacted me. And they're in conjunction with Morrison's at Cleveland's. So I was summoned to Morrison's, and Morrison said, "No, we're going to do this." So that they've produced a lovely hamper, and we've got gifts. People have donated money, so with that money, what I intend to do is some more gifts to buy, and then I will put gas and electric on their card. They have a card for me to over the Christmas period, so you don't have to worry about gas and electric over the Christmas period. So thank you for your response, and the young lady I saw on Monday, she's really overwhelmed. So you've given a needy family a great Christmas, especially in these difficult times. Thank you for that. So we come to light the candle. So Rita, give me a number between 1 and 7. Sorry? Correct, light the candle. So it's getting near, isn't it? It's getting near. And as Peter mentioned this morning, just now, you know, it's occurred to me that the current situation that we're in, the pandemic, what it has done is it enabled us to focus on what Christmas is really all about. Because we haven't been able to plan our parties and our various things. So certainly for me, it's made me sort of look inwards to what Christmas is all about. The real meaning of Christmas. So let's just pray together. We start our service. Our Father in heaven, we ask that as we meet this morning to worship you, that you would be with us, fill us with your Holy Spirit, remind us what this time is all about. Give each one of us strength to get through this period, this time, to who remain focused on you. In your mighty name we pray. Amen. So we're going to begin with our first hymn, which is Tell Out My Soul. Let us hear our Lord's blessing on those who follow him. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who are hungry and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. Blessed are those who suffer persecution for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And let us confess our many failures to keep this way of truth and light. We say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you. Our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. We are heartily sorry and repent of all our sins. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us of all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. May the Father forgive us by the death of his Son. Strengthen us to live in the power of the Spirit all our days. Amen. Amen. So we come to our first reading.
Our first reading is taken from 2 Samuel. Chapter 7, reading verses 1 to 11, and then verse 16. This can be found on page 310 in our Bibles. A passage entitled God's Promise to David. After the king was settled in his palace, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, he said to Nathan the prophet, "Here I am, living in a palace of cedar, while the ark of God remains in a tent." Nathan replied to the king, "Whatever you have in mind, go ahead and do it, for the Lord is with you." That night the word of the Lord came to Nathan, saying, "Go and tell my servant David, this is what the Lord says. Are you the one to build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day I brought the Israelites up out of Egypt to this day. I have been moving from place to place, with the tent as my dwelling. Wherever I have moved with all the Israelites, did I ever say to any of their rulers, whom I commanded to shepherd my people, Israel, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now then, tell my servant David, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture and from following the flock to be ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now I will make your name great, like the names of the greatest men of the earth, and I will provide a place for my people Israel, and will plant them so that they can have a home of their own and no longer be disturbed. Wicked people shall not oppress them any more as they did at the beginning and have done ever since the time I appointed leaders over my people Israel. I will also give you rest from all your enemies. The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. Your house and your kingdom shall endure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever." This is the word of the Lord.
Stand for our gospel reading. In the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Our reading is from Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. It's entitled "The Birth of Jesus Foretold." In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favoured, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, you have found favour with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Thank you.
any ability at all.
Can you move your microphone so it's tucked under your top of the
moment? I might get more of it.
No.
Is that better?
No.
Is it off? It's off. Yeah.
It's off. I can hear it. That's why it squealed.
Yeah. How's that? Is that any better? No?
We might have to take a cuff off. Sorry.
Oh, this thing?
Yes.
It's like a striptease up here. I was going to say as well that if you're going to come to the nativity play, is that better? Yes?
A little bit.
No?
A little bit.
Balancing.
Double.
Is it?
Talk.
Hello?
Yeah.
Right, okay. It's really loud to me now. This is a bad place to preach. I'm not coming here again. Yes, if you come to the nativity play, dress as whatever you like, except the third lobster. You have to see the film to know what that was all about. So, let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray now that you pour out your Spirit upon us, help us to hear and receive your word, take it into our hearts and show it forth in our lives to your glory, honour, and praise. We ask it in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, I guess the passage that we've just had read from the Gospel is one of the most well-known passages. My grandson complained to me that bitterly, he said, that the teacher told us the story that you told me, only she told it differently. She missed bits out. And we managed to work out that she missed out the John the Baptist and the angel Gabriel coming to Elizabeth. And he was outraged that you could miss bits out. Well, Gabriel's been very busy, and in our passage we actually have three servants. So I want to look first of all at the servants' surprise, because angels are, of course, servants of God. We make a great mistake when we look around the world and think that all we can see and touch is all that is there. We already know that even if we are simply staying in the physical world and silence, we cannot see far enough back. There's a theory about a Big Bang, but we can't really see what's happening. Climate change is something we think is new, but actually if you look back over the eons of geological history, you'll find that climate change is actually a regular occurrence. Whether we've caused it or not is a different issue, but certainly climate change has always been happening. And even simple things, as Jesus pointed out, that we know that the wind's there, but we can't see it coming, we can't see it going, we can't see anything about it, except its effect, just like the Holy Spirit. Well, in the same way, there is a spiritual world that we ignore at our peril, but we can't see, we don't know that much about it. We know that this spiritual world has a whole range of spiritual beings. They're not all angels, some of them are cherubim, seraphim, and such like. We also know that, of course, there are demonic elements in that spiritual field. And one of the best things, I think it was C.S. Lewis who said that when the devil is denying his existence, it's the best possible camouflage he can have. So, the very fact we're told, first of all, about an angel, the angel Gabriel, should alert us to this wider reality, which is God's reality. When we talk about God creating the heavens and the earth, the heavens is the spiritual realm, but it's not over there, it's actually here with us. Now, the other thing we can say about angels, by the way, is that they may or may not have wings. But there's no guarantee. In the resurrection narratives, angels are described as young men. However, they are, because they have come from the very presence of God, universally terrifying. There's a painting of some angels, and the angel is reaching out. The angel looks a bit like a little girl in a nice tinsel dress. So it looks a bit like a fairy, really. Angels are not fairies. And he's reaching out to these gnarled shepherds, and underneath he says, "Fear not." And the comment was, is it the shepherds who are telling the little angel not to be frightened, or is it the angel telling? So it's completely misunderstanding the glory, the Shekinah glory of God, which is reflected by the angels. The moment you see an angel in all his glory is the moment you begin to feel the uncomfortableness of your own sin and failing, because God's glory So when the angel is sent from the glory of God to the city of Galilee named Nazareth, Nazareth is a bit of an off-the-beaten track. It had access to the trade routes, but it wasn't on the trade routes. And Galilee as a whole, there's a little further on in John, you'll find that Nathanael says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? That's probably not the general view. That's probably just the local locals having a little go at each other, you know, like us saying, can anything good come out of this book? He says, as living in this book. But Galilee itself, I guess the nearest we could have would be some sort of northern area, maybe like Lancashire or perhaps Yorkshire, as regarded by the south. In Jerusalem, they thought they didn't speak properly, and they were a bit pugnacious and a bit out, really. And so they were looked down upon by the elite of the time. So this is where the angel is sent, and yet he goes there willingly, because that is what a servant does. He goes to Mary, and Mary herself, it's quite interesting, he's going to somebody who's probably only just into her teens. You got engaged, betrothed, and the engagement was so strong that if your husband-to-be died, you were, even though you'd never got formally married, you were described as a widow from that moment on. That's how strong the engagement is. He sent to this girl, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name is Joseph. And again, sometimes because he's a carpenter, we tend to think that he's a bit of a simple artisan. Joseph is not a simple artisan. He's in the house of David. That, of course, is why he ends up having to go to Bethlehem in the census. Joseph, therefore, is of the royal household, of the royal line. In today's language, we'd probably be talking about him as the honourable boy, even the right honourable Joseph, rather than just talking about him as Joseph the carpenter. He is not a peasant. He's part of the royal line. And that's causing me to be very important because he's the adoptive father. Now, this is not about Joseph, but nonetheless, Joseph shows the same characteristics as Mary in that he has been chosen by God for this particular and special task. But if you look on a little bit further, you'll find that the angel is given this task to actually tell, greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you. And then later on, you have found favor with God. That same phrase about finding favor is to be found in Ephesians and in other places, and what it means is not that you're a goody-goody and God really likes you, you've earned your place. It actually means, especially if you look at Ephesians, that you have been graced by God, so God's favour rests upon you, not that you have earned the favour. In other words, Mary's character is no different to yours or mine. Mary is actually demonstrating what it means to be saved by grace and graced service, not that she is a particularly good person. I'm not saying that she's a bad person, but actually it's really important we understand that she is an ordinary human being, a sinful human being, like you, like me, but she has been graced by God for this purpose. And twice we're told that. Now you notice a little bit further on, of course, that the angel then talks in the most gentle and in the most engaging way. The story of the birth of our Saviour is nothing like the pagan myths that are around the time. Pagan myths, mostly from Greek and then adopted by Romans, would have a god who was sort of lusted after some young virgin, came down from heaven, had his wicked way, and produced a demigod, and the demigod would go around doing mighty deeds, but never quite managing to sort of get it right, like Hercules, for instance. Whereas the narrative we have here, in the most delicate and gentle way, describes something completely different. As the angel says, that she asks the question, how is this going to be? The Holy Spirit will come upon you, the power of the Most High will overshadow you, therefore the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. Again, the same language that is being used of the overshadowing is the same language you find in the tabernacle in the Old Testament, when God's Spirit overshadows the tabernacle, and the same language you find on the Mount of Transfiguration, when God's cloud overshadows and out of the cloud, and also Jesus' baptism as well. The same language is being used each time. So the Holy Spirit is going to be sent as the angel. So that's the angel's surprise. You can see Mary's surprise because she says, how can this be? So let's look at the second of the three servants. The second servant is Mary herself. And what we see is the hallmark of the servant. If the first one is doing God's bidding, the second one shows that they are willing to do God's bidding by submission. Of course, that's also going to be part of the hallmark of Jesus' own ministry, submission to the Father and to the will of the Father. But here we see the submission of Mary. The stakes for her are incredibly high. As she actually offers herself in service with those final words, I am a servant, the bond servant, or the handmaid of the Lord, but let it be according to your word. What she is letting go are all her hopes and aspirations. Like most young girls of her age, she would have prayed that she might be the mother of the Messiah, but none of them actually knew how this was going to happen, and all of them just simply prayed it. Mary must have prayed that prayer. It was a common prayer. But now she's faced with a stark reality. She's been engaged probably since she got to double digits. And now the engagement is due to come to the point where she will be married. And that will be when she becomes a mom. The angel's giving her the opportunities, first of all says, you have been graced by God. And she's troubled by the saying. Not troubled by the angel, troubled by the saying. What does it mean? Why is he saying this to me? Why are you looking at me, sort of thing? So she's greatly troubled and trying to work out what the sort of greeting it would be. So the angel then, of course, says, don't worry, you've found favor with God. And goes on and describes what's going to happen. Mary then asks a question. It's not a question of unbelief, it's a question of how will this be? How would this be since I'm a virgin, literally, since I have not known man? And of course, Mary herself may not have Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, which talks about the virgin shall be with child. And the virgin with child in Isaiah can actually be sometimes a young woman who's not necessarily a virgin. But here, the virgin is made very, very clear several times and given the same information. And that's why she's then told the most extraordinary thing, the surprise, that's demanding her submission. What will it mean for Mary? It will mean that she potentially will lose her engagement to Joseph. She may lose her place in her family home. They may turn their backs upon her. She may lose her place in the village. In fact, the extreme condition could be that you, as God's word, this isn't going to happen, that if she gets pregnant, the village could actually turn on her and stone her to death. That was the reality of life in those days. And that's what she, as a young girl, has to suffer. And she looks at the angel, and she knows that she wants to be God's servant. So she gives her permission. And I don't know if you've ever paused to think that the whole of God's plan rests on this cooperation. Yes, it's God's great plan, and yes, he raised Mary for this purpose. Yes, he graced her, but still, he waits for her permission to be the partner in this wonderful moment. And Mary does not disappoint. I am the Lord's servant. The submission of the servant is actually the hallmark of Christian faith. As you look at Mary again, you should be celebrating her as one of the greatest of the saints, if not the greatest. And that she has the very heart of what it is to serve God. She is not superhuman, she is truly human. She is a sinner, but she is graced by God as you are graced by God, and she gives herself into God's service with submission to him, whatever it will bring. Now God sorts it out. She had to trust God. That was all she had, was God's word from an angel who has now disappeared. Then thirdly, our passage of course tells us about the servant's status. We've seen the servant's surprise, which is the angel. We've seen the servant's submission, which is Mary. But of course, this passage is really about Jesus. This passage is about his birth and who he's going to be. And this is about the servant's status. Look again at the passage and you'll see. What are we going to be told about this child? Well, you'll bear a son and you'll call his name Jesus. It's Joseph who's told why he's going to be called Jesus. Jesus, Yeshua, or Joshua, means God saves. And Joseph is told in Matthew's Gospel, you call him Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. From the very beginning, Jesus is named by the task he will fulfill. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. Literally, he is God's Son. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. He is of David's line. And the promises to David will be fulfilled in Jesus. He will reign over the house forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. And because of the way that the Holy Spirit is going to come, he will be holy. He will be called holy, the Son of God. And the angel endorses all of that, of course, by pointing out that the angel is given absolutely the most. The best line, I think, in the whole scripts, when he says that nothing is impossible with God. Or, said the other version had it, his word always achieves its end. Nothing is impossible with God. As servants of God, we listen to what Jesus has said, what is declared about Jesus. As servants of God, we look at Mary and see her submission. As servants of God, we know we might be sent like the angel into a surprising situation, but as servants of God, the answer is always, nothing is impossible with God. Everything is possible, and Jesus is the answer to our every need. And there's one little bit that I wanted to add. Excuse me. The passage that we had read at the beginning from 2 Samuel chapter 7, we missed a little chunk out. And there's a fascinating bit in that. Just listen to what he says again. Now remember, David has decided that he ought to build a house for God. That's what I'm going to do, is build God his house. Nathan, the prophet, hears God saying, you don't need to build a house for me. I'm going to build a place for my people and a house for you, David. But he continues in a bit that we didn't have. The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. When your days are over and you've risen your fathers, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, who will come from your own body. And I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. Forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. When he does wrong, I will punish him with the rod of men, with flogging inflicted by men. For my love will never be taken away from him, as I took it away from Saul, whom I removed from before you. Your house and your kingdom shall endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever. Well, I've always thought that was about Solomon. But as you listen again, the kingdom will be established forever. He will be flogged by the flogging of men. That never happened to Solomon. I will be his father, and he will be my son. The language is pointing very powerfully here in the Old Testament to Jesus as he is to be born. So we are led again to see Jesus has that status. He is the Son of God. He is worthy of our praise and our worship and obedience. But he modeled for us what the servants do. He modeled for us the submission. Mary modeled for us that submission. And the angel modeled for us that submission. It's the angel who gives us the surprise. But I suspect for all of us, not even what Boris thinks, there will be plenty of surprises ahead if we ourselves in service to Christ, like Mary did, like the angel did, and being as the Son himself does to the Father. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that you will pour into our hearts a real sense of your presence, that we may have servant hearts, ready and willing to serve one another, to serve you, and to seek only your glory, honor, and praise. We ask it in your name.
Let us stand together and say the creed, share our faith in God. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We say the collect of today. O Lord, raise up, we pray, your power and come on us, and with great might succour us. But whereas through our sins and wickedness we are grievously hindered in running the race set before us, your bountiful grace and mercy may speedily help and deliver us. Through Jesus Christ, our Son, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be the honour and glory now and forever.
We come to our time of prayer. Let us thank God for his goodness to us in sending his Son Jesus as a baby, and who will bring salvation to those who turn to him. In quietness, let us pray for all who are having difficulties, those who are anxious, those who are sad, those who will miss their loved ones this Christmas. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our
prayers. As we look at the lights, the candles, our main light is Jesus. He is the light of the world. Grant, O Lord, that your great light will overtake us, and the shadows will disappear. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
Let us, in the quietness of our hearts, remember those in our world who don't know you, those in our own country, those in countries where there's very little hope for the future, those living in poverty, for refugees, for those persecuted for their faith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for our government, for those making decisions for us, often decisions which we find hard to accept. But let us all be wise in our actions, thinking of others at this time, doing what is right, and loving each person as you love us.
We pray for those in business, for people who have financial problems during this pandemic. We especially pray for all on the front line, those in the NHS and other frontline services. Lord, in your mercy, let us pray for our church leaders at this time of year, our bishops, Julian, Philip, and Jill, and our clergy, Peter, Matthew, Simon, and also Matt at Hope Church on Grange Park. All residents of Trinity Parish, Clayton, Grange Park, and Staining. We pray for all services that are being held over this Christmas period. And Lord, grant each one your strength and wisdom in dealing with people who are struggling with isolation, loneliness. Lord, in your mercy. Finally, in the quietness of our hearts, let us remember all who are unwell. As Alison Cross and family, Sue Sidebottom, Eileen Murray, Margaret Walsh, Dorothy Archer, the Jeff and Suzanne Gardner, and others who were on our hearts this morning. We pray for all who are bereaved, for family, George Townley, Barbara Doughty, Bill McLaren, Graham Abbott, and Audrey Harrison. Lord, in your mercy, hear the words of the angel. Don't be afraid. I bring good news that will be for all people. So, merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you please stand with me? God will speak peace to his people, to those who turn to him in their hearts. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And let us just turn where we stand and offer a sign of his peace to one another. If you'd like to be seated. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in your tender mercy gave your only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his once and for all offering of himself a full, perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world, he instituted and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. Hear us, merciful Father, we humbly pray, and grant that we, receiving these gifts of your creation, the bread, this bread and this wine, in remembrance of his, according to your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who, on the same night he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's say the prayer that our Saviour taught us together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Like just a prayer, then please just bow your heads. We would love to pray.